Sandy created massive physical damage to the electric power grid. Power lines went down, substations were flooded, all kinds of electric grid infrastructure was devastated by the storm. A cyber attack on the electric power grid would create very different challenges than Superstorm Sandy did. First of all, the kinds of damage that were created look very different. You might not even know initially the cyber attack was the cause of power outages. In a storm, you know, because the wind is knocking down poles and doing everything else that storms do. A carefully designed cyber attack that created power outages, it might not be apparent initially that it was a cyber attack, and certainly it might take some time to discover how the adversary had been able to take down the power grid. But there are three additional differences between what a Superstorm Sandy type event does and what a cyber attack would do in terms of power restoration. First of all, I mentioned before that power companies in the New York area were able to restore power quickly because in addition to their own resources, terrific plans and capabilities, they were able to draw on support from utilities across the nation. And if you were in California, you could send your restoration crews to New York knowing that Sandy was never going to hit you. In a cyber attack, you won't have that confidence. If you're a utility CEO, you may be worried that the same attackers who struck a utility in New York or Florida might attack you next. You might be a little reluctant to send your scarce cyber restoration assets in order to help someone else restore their power. The second issue is that of the tasks that are required for power restoration. In Superstorm Sandy, crews could come from California and they knew how to restring wire. They knew how to put up utility poles because those tasks are substantially the same between California and New York. Cyber attacks can attack the operating technology systems, the industrial control systems, the PLCs, everything else that is required to operate the modern power grid. Those operating technology systems and networks look very different from company to company. And so if you're good at your own company's operating technology networks, that knowledge doesn't transfer very easily to another utility. And in fact, you may wreck another company's operating technology system because you lack the expertise to safely operate on it. Third big issue that I believe is different between Sandy and a cyber attack is the strategic communications. What do you say to the public? What do you say to the public? Superstorm Sandy is very important to have unity of message between government and utilities on, okay, when are we going to get power restored? What can citizens expect? What's coming next? In a cyber attack, when the adversary is attempting to create panic, when he may be able to launch re-attacks on systems, when there'll be terrific uncertainty that the adversary is trying to create, that's a very different messaging environment. What motivated me to write this study for the Applied Physics Laboratory is that coming out of the Department of Defense, I was convinced that a top threat to the national security of the United States was the risk that an adversary might seek to selectively target the electric power grid, potentially other infrastructure, in order to achieve political and military effects in an intense regional crisis. I decided that was such an important topic that I'd worked on when I was in office that I'd continue that kind of analysis once I retired, once I joined the private sector, and that's what's motivated me to work together with the team at the Applied Physics Laboratory to write this study. I want to say a few words about the possible scope and severity of cyber attacks that could occur. My former boss, Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta, was concerned that a cyber attack could occur on the United States that would look like a cyber Pearl Harbor. That is a massive cyber attack combined with targeted physical attacks on key components of the electric power grid that potentially could bring down the power grid over wide areas of the United States for extended periods. That is a concern. I respect those who focus on that risk. I think there's also a substantial risk, maybe a greater risk, that instead of a bolt out of the blue attack on a massive scale, cyber attack could be much more targeted and could grow out of a regional conflict, some part of the world, where as political tensions escalated, the very first thing that an adversary might do would be to take down selected portions of the U.S. power grid in order to create political and military effects on the bases that might be important for deploying forces to those regions in a way that could help that adversary prevail in the crisis. I think we need to think not only about the risk of a cyber Pearl Harbor, but perhaps focus on more targeted, selective attacks that could arise out of regional crises that could happen any day. We can think of a cyber attack as occurring in three phases. In the first phase, when utilities discover they are under attack, when the lights begin to go off. The second phase will come as they attempt to restore power, first with relatively small power islands, areas that have managed to survive the attack, and surrounding areas that have escaped attack. Gradually, electric utilities will be able to enlarge these power islands, both through black start capabilities and by importing power from outside the blacked out region, and gradually get to a new normal. Maybe not as much electric service as existed before the attack, but still a relatively stable, dependable supply of electric power, certainly to the most important customers. America's need to think more about is what I'll call the reconstitution phase. The second phase is going well. We've restored power to most Americans. We're doing as best we can. And then the third phase is, how should we think about reconstituting the power grid, reconstructing the power grid in ways that make it inherently more survivable against future attacks? There'll be a political opportunity, an economic opportunity, an organizational opportunity to borrow from the lessons learned of 9/11. Before 9/11, it was impossible to establish a Department of Homeland Security, even though I believe the nation needed one. After 9/11, after the tragedy, the Department of Homeland Security was established. What I think we should be doing now is, of course, everything that we can to prevent a cyber attack from occurring, but also begin to think long-term, if, heaven forbid, a successful cyber attack occurs, what kinds of plans do we want to have in our back pocket in order to help utilities rebuild the grid, help government prepare to support industry in ways that are more effective than currently exist today. The first thing that utilities can do when they know they've been suffering a cyber attack is to reach back to the sources of information and analysis that can help them understand how they've been attacked, what kinds of malware is on their systems, and what it's going to take to restore power. So, a great initial starting point is the Electric Subsector Information and Analysis Center, the EISAC, where industry gets to share information across utilities on threat signatures, other valuable information for knowing how the attack may have occurred. And of course, utilities can then provide samples of their malware to the EISAC, so that can get shared more widely. Then the Department of Homeland Security, the Department of Energy, other federal departments and agencies can support this flow of information. And again, get the two-way flow going. That's going to be necessary as the United States prepares to effectively respond to the cyber attack. The nation's top priorities to strengthen preparedness for cyber attacks are, above all, to continue to strengthen our efforts to protect the electric power grid from attack, make it more difficult to take down. Industry is making great strides in that endeavor. But secondly, we need to assume that despite our best efforts, somehow the adversary will break in, will successfully take down the power grid. For industry to continue to leverage its terrific expertise in restoring power after events like Superstorm Sandy, familiar hazards. Take that as a foundation on which to build. And now think about what's different about cyber attacks. What are the specific tasks that are going to be required to accelerate the restoration of power in a cyber event? And then how can government actually be of value to industry as those restoration operations go forward? That's the analysis. That's the consensus building that needs to go forward today.